particular program is underwritten by Gil Steil Associates, and Gil is here, right there. To our speaker. Emily Bernard is professor of English and critical race and ethnic studies at the University of Vermont. Her books include Remember Me to Harlem, The Letters of Hank Langston Hughes and Carl Van Vechten. That book is here in the collection, which is a New York Times, was a New York Times notable book of the year. Some of My Best Friends, Writers on Interracial Friendships. That book is also in the collection, available for circulation. Chosen by the New York Public Library as a book for the teen age. And Michelle Obama, The First Lady in Photographs, a book she co-authored with Deborah Willis, which received a 2010 NAACP Image Award. Her most recent book, Carl Van Vechten and the Harlem Renaissance, A Portrait in Black and White, was published by Yale University Press in 2012. We do not yet have a copy. It did not arrive. I apologize. It will be here soon. Her essays have been published in anthologies and journals such as The American Scholar. There are terrific essays online you can read of Professor Bernard. Green Mountains Review, Oxford American Magazine, Reader's Digest, Best American Essays, Best African American Essays, and Best Creative Nonfiction. She has received fellowships from the Alphonse A. Fletcher Foundation, Yale University, the Ford Foundation, the National Endowment for the Humanities, the W.E.B. Du Bois Institute at Harvard University. She was named a recipient of a 2014-2015 creation grant by the Vermont Arts Council. Please welcome Professor Emily Bernard.
Hi, everybody. Good evening. I want to thank Bob Jolly, who's been so kind and accommodating working out the details of this visit. I'm also grateful to Allie White, who has been inviting me to do speaking engagements for the Vermont Humanities Council. I've enjoyed it, and I hope to give you your money's worth tonight. Toni Morrison's book, Beloved, is the topic tonight. Here she is in 1989, in an interview with The World magazine. She says, "There is no place you or I can go to think about or not think about, to summon the presences of or recollect the absences of slaves. Nothing that reminds us of the ones who made the journey and of those who did not make it. There is no suitable memorial or plaque or wreath or wall or park or skyscraper lobby. There's no 300-foot tower. There's no small bench by the road. There is not even a tree scored, an initial that I can visit or you can visit in Charleston or Savannah or New York or Providence, or better still, on the banks of the Mississippi. And because no such place exists, the book had to." Toni Morrison's inspiration for her Pulitzer Prize-winning 1987 novel was a newspaper clipping in The Black Book, a 1974 scrapbook of the African-American experience. In its pages were photographs of black men being lynched while white men stood by and smiled. There were advertisements for the public sale of Negroes and other ads for items like spool cotton and sunlight soap that featured caricatures of black children. But there were also images of families dressed in their Sunday finest and soldiers who helped break the color barrier in the US military. Morrison was among a team of editors who assembled the volume. Among these pictures and newspaper clippings and sheet music and postcards was a small item about a slave named Margaret Garner, a mother who had killed one of her children rather than see her grow up in slavery. She had tried and failed to kill her other children as well. A mulatto about 5 feet high, showing a quarter or a third white blood. This is how she was described by Levi Coffin, who directed the Underground Railroad in the crucial border city of Cincinnati. She had a high forehead, her eyebrows were finely arched, and her eyes bright and intelligent. She appeared to be 22 or 23. She was dressed in dark calico with a white handkerchief arranged as a turban around her head. The babe she held in her arms was a little girl about 9 months old and was much lighter in color than herself, light enough to show a red tinge in its cheeks. Originally, on Margaret Garner's mind was not murder, but freedom. Along with seven other slaves in Kentucky, she had attempted to escape to Ohio, which was only several miles away. They had planned their escape carefully over several months. All seven managed to cross the Ohio River, arriving in Covington by horse-driven sleighs. Once there, they divided up. One group made it to Canada via the Underground Railroad. The other group, Garner's group, which consisted of her family, was discovered while they were hiding in the home of a free black man who had just left to find Coffin, whose role it was to get the fugitive slaves to the next step of their journey. Garner and her family barricaded themselves inside the house where Garner killed her three-year-old girl. The oldest of her children was five. Garner was immediately jailed. After a series of public hearings ensued, the newspapers carried day-by-day accounts of the proceedings, as if they constituted a serialized novel. It was a scandal of its time. Every day, the courtroom was packed. Then came the indictment. We find that said child, Mary Garner, was killed by its mother, Margaret Garner, with a butcher's knife with which she cut its throat. Garner had many sympathizers among abolitionists. They wanted her tried for murder, which would have set a number of precedents, including establishing an enslaved person's rights and responsibilities regarding her own children. Instead, Margaret Garner was accused of destruction of property and remanded to slavery along with her husband. Among Garner's many supporters was Lucy Stone, the most eloquent orator of this female suffrage movement. Stone addressed the crowded courtroom during her summation after testimonies had been heard. She described Garner and her visit to Garner in jail, where she told her that 1,000 hearts were aching for her. In court, Garner described Margaret, in court, Lucy Stone described Margaret Garner's predicament. "The faded faces of the Negro children," she said, "tell too plainly to what degradation female slaves submit. Rather than give her little daughter to that life, she killed it. If in her deep maternal love, she felt the impulse to save it from coming woe, who are we to say she had no right to do so? That desire had its roots in the deepest and holiest feelings of our nature, implanted alike in black and white by our common father. With my own teeth, would I rather tear open my veins and let the earth drink my blood, rather than wear the chains of slavery? How then could I blame her for wishing her child to find freedom with God and the angels, where no chains are? Can we blame her?" "It was the right thing to do, but she had no right to do it." Toni Morrison said this about Garner's choice in an interview, and here she is discussing the process of beginning the story.
"But I really wanted to talk about that incident with a historical figure. But I was really upset because I had to talk about..."
Okay. Bob here? I need some help with the audio here.
Sorry, I'm just a second.
Oh no, thanks for.
Can we get the audio louder on the TV?
We're having the same problem with the audio.
Do we have a remote for this?
We do. It's hanging on the back. Sorry, folks. Yeah, the volume control is on there.
Can we try that? Just try it.
Fire it up again.
Maybe in particular. Because I assume.
Okay, sure. That about okay.
And I didn't want to dredge it up. I.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Deliberately, I remember thinking about Beloved, I really don't want to do this. I really wanted to talk about that incident with a historical figure who had did. But I was really upset because I had to talk about slavery in particular. Because I assume I knew everything anyway, so. And I didn't want to dredge it up. The same thing I'm accusing everybody else of, because emotionally it's difficult.
Yes, yes.
So I did, and it was very, very hard, not so much to find the language for it, that was difficult enough, but for me, in the process of writing, it is just not authentic or legitimate enough for me to look at it from the outside. You know, I always tell my students, it's not a black father, it's yours.
Yes.
You know the one you know?
Yes.
That one. So if I'm going to imagine what it takes to kill your baby, then I have to put in my arms the one that.
Get into the feelings.
That's right.
Yes.
And when that happens, and it's difficult, then you. The language just pairs down. You don't get ornamental with that. You get very still, very clean land, very quiet. Because there's the event itself is really language.
But you have to want to know that.
But you have to
yes.
want to know that.
Yes.
So you get there. So you get there and say it.
That's right.
Somebody asked me once, they said, where's that part? In Beloved, I can't find it where she actually has him. And I said, I don't know. And I said, it was so buried. I mean, you know it all along because they said so. But the actual moment when it happens is so buried in the text, you can barely find it, which is.
Okay. Beloved is not. And does not pretend to be a faithful representation of the story of Margaret Garner. There's a wonderful illustrated edition of the book, and so these are some images by Joe Morris, who did the illustrations. Set in 1873, roughly a decade after the Emancipation Proclamation ended slavery, at least in theory, Beloved is a story of Setha, a former slave who 18 years earlier had escaped to Ohio from Sweet Home, a plantation in Kentucky. She sent her three babies ahead of her, two little boys and one yet unnamed girl. On the way, she gave birth to another daughter, Denver. Setha was tracked to her new home by the man who owned her. She reacted by cutting the throat of her crawling already older daughter and would have done the same with her other children had she not been stopped. For destruction of property, the child as slave, she served a jail sentence. By the time she was released, the ghost of the dead baby, Beloved, which was the name Setha had inscribed on the headstone of her grave, had come to haunt the house that the family occupied. Partly because they feel encumbered by the destructive and terrifying ghosts, And partly because they are afraid of their mother, who, after all, murdered their sister, the two boys leave home as soon as they can take care of themselves. Setha and Denver accept the baby ghost and the disruptions that she causes as part of their lives. Everything changes when another former slave from Sweet Home, Paul D, arrives. With brute force, he rids the house of the ghost, and he and Setha become lovers. Soon after, an unknown young woman arrives. She behaves strangely and appears to be the age that the dead body baby would have been had she lived. She calls herself Beloved and soon becomes a powerful force in the house. Beloved forces Paul D out, first from the house and then from Setha's life. Meanwhile, Setha, the target of Beloved's attention and the person from whom she seeks retribution, cannot keep from becoming completely enthralled by the intruder. For Setha believes that Beloved is the reincarnation of the child she murdered. As a result, Setha suffers from physical and psychological deterioration until Denver, anxious for her mother's life, seeks help from the black women in the community. Under the gaze of the collective force of the women who respond to the call, Beloved disappears. And for the first time in her life, Denver finds the courage to make life plans that promise positive changes for the entire community. The story concludes with Paul D's return to a recovering Setha, to whom he offers himself in a partnership for a life they will build together. Morrison said that the only way to tell the story she needed to tell was from the perspective of the child that was killed. Beloved is the only one entitled to sit in judgment upon Setha, Morrison said. I just imagine the life of the dead girl, which was the girl Margaret Garner killed, and I call her Beloved so that I could filter all of these confrontations and questions that she has in that situation. Beloved is more than a character in the novel. She is the embodiment of the past that must be remembered in order to be forgotten. She symbolizes what must be reincarnated in order to be buried. She is the embodiment of rememory, a term that dominates the book, and which means a kind of psychic haunting in which the specifics of a traumatic incident are told and retold. Even the teller tries to block their full emergence into the conscious mind. In a 1989 interview, Morrison calls Beloved a book about something that the characters don't want to remember, I don't want to remember, black people don't want to remember, and white people don't want to remember. Morrison's project is monumental and precise, which is to intervene in the tradition of national amnesia regarding this chapter in American history. Just as the nation must come to grips with its history, so must the slave find a way to recognize the horrors of her past. The importance of our private memories becomes the basis for a reconstructed public history. In the tradition of African American literature, private memories and public histories have been inextricably intertwined since the inception of the tradition, which begins with the slave narrative. And this is an image from the original edition of the narrative of the life of Frederick Douglass, which was published in 1845. Morrison acknowledges the influence of slave narratives on her work. She says, the matrix of the work I do is extend, fill, and complement slave autobiographical narratives, she said. Slave narratives comprise one of the most extensive and influential traditions in literature. Nowhere else in the world can you find, except for outside of the body of work produced by African-American slaves, can you find a body of work written by people testifying to the horrors and complexities of their own enslavement? as historical sources, slave narratives document slave life, primarily in the American South, from the invaluable perspective of firsthand experience. The most influential slave narratives of the antebellum era were designed to enlighten white readers about the realities of slavery as an institution and the humanity of black people as individuals deserving of full human rights. In the late 18th and 19th centuries, early 19th century, slave narratives became an important means of opening a dialogue between blacks and whites about slavery and freedom. Whatever the style and circumstances of these narratives, they were written to say principally two things, Morrison writes in her 1987 essay, The Site of Memory. One, this is my historical life, my singular, special example that is personal, but that also represents the race. And two, I write this text to persuade other people, you, the reader, who is probably not black, that we are human beings worthy of God's grace and the immediate abandonment of slavery. But there was a creative cost for writers of slave narratives who recognized their work as responding only to political urgency. Over and over, the writers pull the narrative up short with a phrase such as, but let us drop a veil over these proceedings, too terrible to relate, Morrison writes. In shaping the experience to make it palatable for those who were in a position to alleviate it, they were silent about many things, and they forgot many things. For me, Morrison continues, a writer in the last quarter of the 20th century, not much more than 100 years after emancipation, a writer who is black and a woman, my job becomes how to rip the veil drawn over proceedings too terrible to relate. The exercise is also critical for any person who is black or belongs to any marginalized category, for historically, we were seldom invited to participate in the discourse, even when we were its topic. The act of ripping the veil requires more than the recovery of buried stories. It requires invention. Memories and recollections won't give me total access to the unwritten interior life of these people, Morrison writes. Only the act of imagination can help me. Slave narratives have always been full of imagination, and because of this, they were bestsellers, stories of tragic victims, perfect villains, and heroic escapes. Such drama translates easily to the silver screen. Among the most memorable cinematic adventures in the representation of slavery have been the 1997 miniseries Roots, Sankofa, which was produced in 1993, Amistad in 1997, 12 Years a Slave, recently in 2013, and the 2012 movie Django Unchained. Has anybody seen that movie? You know, I will go out on a limb and say it's worthwhile. Do you agree with me? I think it's very interesting. It's really different. And I have to admit, I found it quite riveting, in large part because of the way that it reimagines this iconic image that circulated among abolitionist literature, and that is the slave's back, the male slave's back. And this is an image that was very important. Peter the Slave, it was titled, and often featured in abolitionist literature, just anonymously, this man who actually was served in the army, but here his back, it tells a real story. The ravaged back of the black American slave is the most honest and absolutely legible account of slavery. It is the irrefutable evidence of the utter inhumanity of the institution. Like this image, Django's scarred back is an image that needs no accompanying words in order to evoke our shame, rage, and disgust. The only thing is, through Tarantino's lens, and with an accompanying whoosh, as a blanket follows from Django's shoulders, that back is glorious, not as much a mark of degradation but a mark of virility and survival. It might seem far-fetched to put Django enchained and Beloved in conversation, but both the film and the novel reveal the problem that has faced every artist who has taken on a subject like American slavery, which is how to represent it. However and wherever it has been represented, the landscape of slavery is always the same, which is the body. A veritable science was made to keep the black body in place. These are, of course, images of instruments of torture that were meant to punish and harness black people. And this is the bit, that covered Paul D's face in Beloved that comes up a lot in the book. These awful images force us to confront things that we need not confront if we choose not to do so. Like Morrison and James Baldwin before her, I believe that any African-American with a podium is mandated to insist that her audience bear witness to the unspeakable. "We should always be shocked," Toni Morrison said once in an interview, referring to the violence that people habitually visit upon one another all over the world. We should never become immune. "Slavery is terrible for men," wrote Harriet Jacobs in her masterful 1861 narrative, Incidents in the Life of a Slave Girl, "but it is far more terrible for women. Slavery acts on the male body, but it invades the female body. The sexual exploitation of enslaved black women was its own instrument of torture, and so widespread that it is a staple feature in the writings of those who witnessed and experienced black life under slavery. In Beloved, Setha pays for the engraving of her dead daughter's tombstone by submitting to 10 minutes of sex with the engraver as her son watched. The maternity of enslaved black women was overdetermined and considered another right of the slave owner. This is a common scene. Black women often called upon to serve as wet nurses for white children, which always astounds me. The paradoxes that are inherent in the slave, in the institution. On one hand, you contend that black and white people are forever separate, even different species, and that black people are almost subhuman. And yet you ask them to attend to the details, the most intimate details of your life. I mean, these are the contradictions that make the institution so peculiar. "Why does a slave ever love?" Harriet Jacobs writes wistfully in her book, Incidents in the Life of a Slave Girl. In the book, Jacobs describes the bonds of love that kept her shackled to her children and to slavery as securely as a rope or iron. Maternal love was something more, sometimes more of a burden than a blessing. The maternity that was demanded of slave women in the service of white families was not a privilege enslaved black women could extend to their own children. And here's an image. Can a mother forget her suckling child? You know, it's really worthwhile. There are wonderful oral histories recorded by the WPA that are available online and archived by the Library of Congress of former slaves talking about their experiences. And one of the things, one of the kind of staple features, if you will, of the experiences of these people was forced separation from children. It's hard to imagine the agony, you know, and how capricious it was. Slave owners just deciding one day, that's it, and never seeing your mother or your child again. Why allow the tendrils of the heart to twine around objects which may at any moment be wrenched away by the hands of violence? Three times in Incidents, Jacobs tells us that if it weren't for her children, she would welcome death. When she finally escapes, it is not a lack, but rather a surplus of motherly love that motivates her flight. And often in that book, she wishes that her children would simply just not wake up. Enslaved black women who became mothers were faced with awful choices. Morrison's novels are replete with mothers wrestling with the demands of their own maternity. Motherhood is lethal in Morrison's body of work. Setha is hardly unique. In Sula, Eva Peace, the consummate maternal figure, kills her own son by setting fire to his bedroom. Others like Ruth in Song of Solomon and Arnett in Paradise try to abort their babies. Other mothers, Pauline in The Bluest Eye, a book on my mind tonight, and Rose Dear in Jazz, inflict their own kind of pain, abandoning their role as caregivers. Motherhood is ironic in Morrison's work. Women kill their children in order to save them. Your love is too thick, Paul D says to Setha. Love is, or it ain't. Then love ain't any love at all, Setha tells him. When African-American women, enslaved and free, took to lecterns, pen, and paper, it was to demonstrate their humanity through their insistence on their motherhood. Beloved is Morrison's contribution to the tradition of black women determined to reveal the tragic inheritance that slavery had bequeathed them. It's an image of Setha's back. And when the top of her dress was around her hips, and he saw what the sculpture on her back had become, like the decorative work of a locksmith, too passionate for display, he could not think, but he could say, "Ah, Lord, girl." It's Paul D regarding Setha's back. The narrative of Beloved is embodied quite literally by Setha. It is written on her back. It is not the magnetic back of Django's, but it also isn't the degraded back like the image of Peter the slave. It is indisputably an awful back. Awful meaning both terrible and something that inspires reverential wonder and fear. Setha is ashamed of her back, just as she is ashamed of her past and the desperate choice that she made. In order to heal, she must face the legacy that is inscribed on her skin and materialized in the ghost of her murdered baby. At the outset of the novel, Setha's future was a matter of keeping the past at bay. The skin on her back had been dead for years, we read, signifying her attempts to repress the past. For Setha, these scars constitute traces of past deeds too horrible and violent either to forget or remember, a situation that Morrison calls a perfect dilemma. The brutal whipping she received as punishment for her attempt to run away is only one part of a cluster of events that Setha seeks to forget. There is no forgetting in Beloved. The dead rises up and demands to be reckoned with, to be seen. It's painful. Anything dead coming back to life hurts, says Amy Denver, a runaway white girl who plays an important role in the novel. Not only does she save Setha's life and midwife the delivery of her daughter, Denver, Amy rereads Setha's back for her. See, here's the trunk. It's red and split wide open, full of sap. And this here's the parting for the branches. Leaves, too, look like. And darn if these ain't blossoms. Tiny little cherry blossoms. Your back got a whole tree on it in bloom. Baby Suggs, Setha's mother-in-law, sees Setha's back as a pattern of roses of blood. Paul D calls it a sculpture. It is important to remember the fact that these readings of Setha's back are performed first by a white girl, also a fugitive escaping indentured servitude, and a black man, and then a black woman. These are the readers of a text, Setha's back, written by a white man. Enslavement is a process of dismemberment. Africans were divested of their culture, language, and names. Slavery alienated them from their own bodies. And beloved schoolteacher, the vicious slave owner who comes to wreak havoc on Sweet Home after the death of its previous owner, who was a humane man, relatively speaking. He's also, importantly, a writer schoolteacher. He is writing a book about slaves, and Setha is charged with mixing his ink. In schoolteacher's book, which mirrors the overarching narrative of slavery itself, Setha is an animal, a savage. She is forced to submit to the bovine humiliation of being milked in a grotesque parody of Madonna and Child. Setha must take charge of her body, her story, and create a counter-narrative. For the unlettered slave, the act of writing is the act of remembering what has been dismembered. And beloved, remembering is the only way to heal. The power of words is manifested not only in storytelling, and beloved, but also in the specific textual verbal art of preaching. I'll come back to that quote in a minute. And here's Baby Suggs.
Let the children come. Let your mothers hear you laugh.
Baby Suggs, who's a real heroic figure in the book, is described as a woman of words, which puts her on par with schoolteacher in his godly commands at Sweet Home and his authorship of the master narrative. But Baby Suggs is not a traditional preacher. The crowds gather in the clearing here to hear her words on a Saturday afternoon, not on Sunday morning. She tells them the only grace they could have was the grace they could imagine. In other words, they are the masters of their own fates. The day Baby Suggs becomes free after more than 60 years of slavery, she notices her own heartbeat and is thrilled at owning her own body for the first time. She then opens her great heart to those who could use it, by becoming an unchurched preacher. Baby Suggs performs a secular miracle through the force of her own imagination, creating a ritual to heal former slaves and enable them to seek a reconciliation with their memories, whose scars survive long, even generations after the experience of slavery had ended. Her sermons are deeply secular, In this here place, she tells those who come to hear her speak, we flesh, flesh that weeps and laughs, flesh that dances on bare feet in grass, love it hard. Yonder they do not love your flesh, they despise it. No more do they love the skin on your back. Yonder they flay it. And oh, my people, they do not love your hands. Those they only use, tie, bind, chop off, and leave empty. Love your hands, love them. Raise them up and kiss them. Touch others with them. Pat them together, stroke them on your face, because they don't love that either. You've got to love it, you. And no, they ain't love you with your mouth. They ain't in love with your mouth. Yonder out there, they will see it broken and break it again. What you say out of it, they will not heed. What you put into it to nourish your body, they will snatch away and give leavens instead. No, they don't love your mouth. You got to love it. Toni Morrison has said, it's always seemed to me that Black people's grace has been with what they do with language. Once she was asked what she considered distinctive or good about her fiction. Language, she replied, it is a thing that Black people love so much, the saying of words, holding them on your tongue, experimenting with them, playing with them. It's a love, a passion. It functions like a preacher's to make you stand up out of your seat, make you lose yourself and hear yourself. And beloved, healing begins with the body and the stories that they tell. Toni Morrison's novel is not only concerned with the remembering of individual characters, but with the body politic, the national scar of American race relations. There's a lot of talk about colorblindness I hear in my classrooms and in public discourse. Colorblindness is not progress. It's not a sign of moving forward, it is a sign of moving backward. It's a failure. We fail one another by pretending not to see what is right in front of us, from the systematic injustices that virtually determine the way Blackness is lived in this country, down to the differences that are written on our skins. This quotation comes from a remarkable book, I don't know if you've had a chance to read it, The New Jim Crow, which itself is testimony about the legacy of slavery and the way it works kind of invisibly in the margins in our country. Beloved reminds us that race and racism are not abstractions. The wounds of our past are not healed. In fact, careful readers of the world around us know that, like the characters in Beloved, there is no repressing the past. In fact, repression functions as another form of subjugation. When we've claimed to forget, insist on a national amnesia, the past rises up and is hungry for blood. I was fascinated reading Between the World and Me, Ta-Nehisi Coates, and the metaphor of the body that really functions as a thread in the text. It reminded me so much of Morrison. All our phrasing, race relations, racial chasms, racial justice, racial profiling, white privilege, even white supremacy, serves to obscure the fact that racism is a visceral experience, that it dislodges brains, blocks airways, rips muscle, extracts organs, cracks bones, and breaks teeth. Remembering is a collective act. I want to get to this quote now. James Baldwin, excuse me, before I wrote this for a minute. From The Fire Next Time, which inspired Between the World and Me. If we, and now I mean the relatively conscious whites and the relatively conscious blacks, who must, like lovers, insist on or create the consciousness of the others, we do not falter in our duty now. We may be able, handful that we are, to end the racial nightmare and achieve our country and change the history of the world. Remembering is a collective act. It is not the responsibility of black people or white people exclusively to end racism, and it won't be easy. We must dismember the master narrative in order to compose a new one. Beloved is an old story about an older story. This is not a story to pass on. We are told at the end of the book, it is our responsibility to remember the horrors of slavery in order to heal from them. Morrison asks her readers to confront the debt assumed by the traumas of slavery to enable us to transform this inheritance into a beloved future. But this is also not a story to pass on. Beloved compels the reader to reimagine a concealed past as a reparative starting point, which not only summons the ghastly foundations of our nation, but in so doing, initiates conversations surrounding what was lost, established, and still owed. Only then can we close the book and put the story to bed. That's it. Thank you. I'm dying to hear your questions and your comments. It's a fascinating story, I think. But I'm also always interested, and I ask my students this, is there another moment in American history that is recounted so obsessively in our culture than the era of slavery? I mean, not the civil rights movement, but you know what I'm talking about? It's really interesting, and I think it speaks to the anxiety we have as a country. Still have not been able to reconcile ourselves to this horrible era. So what do we do about it? We keep recounting, retelling the story, finding different ways to get into it. And I find it very interesting, all the variations that are so, I mean, we're reading my class, 12 Years a Slave, and we've talked about narration and storytelling, and the movie that was, you know, so popular. Why? Why is it so interesting? Why is it still so compelling? I mean, these stories are dramatic. They're profound because they're stories about, I think, ultimately about what it means to be human. You know, how do we exert our, what do we do? What are our values? What do we cherish? These are the stories. This is, in fact, of course, what's at the heart of Beloved. To love your children so much that you would murder them. So violently, what is that? Is it something we could ever imagine doing? And as Morrison says, she really, I think, demands that of us as readers, that we really try to understand what that horrible choice was like. Yes?
Have you seen Fences?
I've not seen it yet. I'm dying to see it.
Can I repeat the question?
Fences, if I've seen Fences yet. Yeah.
I just wondered because it just seems as if all of the pain and suffering, August Wilson kind of funnels it through this character. And it's a very powerful.
Yeah. I saw it many, many years ago when it was as a play. And I remember that. And August Wilson was just also, I think, much like Morrison, that he saw his artwork as having a greater function, right? That it had to testify, it had to almost serve as a repository of experience. You know, he did all of it was decade by decade. He wanted to remember African American experience and also remember the forgotten. You know, stories are stories of everyday people, people who, you know, whose stories are often not recorded. You know, I mean, it's that cliche that history is written by the victors. It's so meaningful. And so that's what he was an archivist, he was an artist. And he was somebody who understood that his activism was deeply entrenched in his art. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you.
I hope I can make all of my points. I saw Birth of a Nation, and it was the only one in the theater. Wow. We had it here in St. Johnsbury. And it gave me another viewpoint in the co-opting people of color, slaves, to be the instruments of the master, and at what point you realize it and how you use it to change. I truly appreciate somebody who's an arts educator using the arts. My concern is that the dominant culture sees it as art and doesn't see it as a mechanism to answer larger questions. The pain that traveled from slavery to today, as a mother of a black son who is incarcerated, so that we still today carry that legacy. It's alive and well, it's alive and well here in Vermont. The disproportionate numbers of black men who are incarcerated, 10% of the prison population compared to 1% of the general population. What that does to the mother, what it does to family. The I don't see color means you don't see me. You have invalidated my being. And my other concern is in this wave of counter to our new administration and these popping ups of community building, sustaining communities, and race is not part of it. And if race is not considered, then you are perpetuating racism. If it's not brought into the conversation, it's being perpetuated. And in a state like ours, and especially here in the Northeast Kingdom, we are that much more isolated. It behooves people who want change to step up. It's also interesting around relationships. So that relationship of how do you have interracial relationships? What are the dynamics? How do you get through those barriers to move forward? And I work with an organization around building the beloved community. So how do we raise up Dr. King instead of just a day of service? What can, and that's what I would like to hear from the community, what actions can they take to support people of color, especially black people here in the Northeast Kingdom?
That's a great question. So let's hear it. Let's have, what do you think? Let's have some response. Yes?
Well, I think you take for granted, you know, like this institution, the Athenaeum, the money talk for it came from Fairbanks. Fairbanks is the money in slavery. You know, it was a big industry, and cotton was the major products for the Civil War. So at least up to that point, you know, I don't know how much part of the business it was, but it's in part of our whole society, slavery.
It's foundational, right? To the fabric of who we are in this country. But may I ask your name?
Sha'an Bouguer.
So I'd like to hear some more discussion, because I think it sort of, that's in some ways what the book is asking. You know, what is our personal responsibility? What can we do? What do we do? That's a big question.
I'd like to ask, I'm not arguing with you, I just don't understand what we could do here, since we have so few people of color in the Northeast Kingdom, but all over Vermont. What are you thinking, idea that is possible for us to do? What was your suggestion here?
Perhaps the first suggestion would be to understand the dominant culture, for you to understand how you benefit from being white, to be able to tap into maybe how you yourself have been oppressed. And you know, I said there's a, and begin to explore that, to break out your own shell in order to do that. Discover what resources there may be. I'm a resource. Discover what resources, I'm one of many resources here. Start to educate yourself.
I'm not arguing with you, I still don't understand how doing all those things are going to help the situation. That's all. I mean, sure, we should be educated in Beloved in this lecture.
So I'll give you an example. If in fact you clearly understood, you might want to take a look at how students are being treated in schools. You may start to look and say, I look around the community, do we have the health professionals to take care? And I'll give you an example. I hope to grow old in this community. I don't feel safe enough to have someone take care of me. Right now, I'm dealing with a Confederate flag hanging in one of my neighbor's windows. So just where I live, I don't feel safe. Wouldn't it be wonderful if others said, this is not how we want St. Johnsbury to be represented. Let's get a hold of Rural Edge and say, this is not a welcoming community. Let's take a look at how we are teaching our children. Is that a little bit more concrete for you?
Well, it is. I wasn't aware of the Confederate flag. I think, on the other hand, Dr. Sprowski is an active doctor, and I'm a retired surgeon. I can tell you, at least from a medical point of view, I don't think you have to worry about racism being part of your medical condition. Now, in terms of other parts of society,
I really beg to differ. I beg to differ.
Okay.
Because there are children of color who have gone to doctors in our community, and they put down sickle cell anemia only because they've seen that child. They don't know the issues that are concerning African Americans. They don't know that we have a higher percent of high blood pressure. We have a higher percent of diabetes.
And prostate cancer.
And prostate cancer.
I think they do know that. I know those things, I'm sure Dr. Sprowski does.
So that's not getting out to the community.
Okay?
So you knowing it in a bubble is not getting it out in community. There aren't any mental health professionals of color here in our community.
There was Marie Latoya when I came here, 30 years, the main psychiatrist, Marie Latoya was a black woman. She was terrific. We were really sorry when she left.
She's left.
And her husband was also he was actually a member of many of the important clubs in town, Synapse, Walden Club, and so on. So he was, I think they both felt like members of the community. They just felt old like the rest of us. I don't think they felt, I shouldn't speak to them, but I'm just saying they were well integrated into the society, at least as far as anybody can tell, at least as far as I can tell. So I'm not saying there is no racism. I'm just saying I'm not sure what we can do about it, about the major problem where it really counts, like downtown Philadelphia or other places when we're up here, really reading about it in the newspaper.
So you might want to might want to check out what kinds of incidents of racism might have happened at the academy. You might want to check out what's going on at Lyndon State College.
It would be. I'd be interested to hear your impression. I'm not aware of any of those. So,
again, if you know people of color, if you don't know people of color, how do you know get to know people of color?
Well, that's to get to almost know, nobody to get to know here. That's what I'm saying.
And again, I feel invisible. Mm-hmm. I'm here. I walk down the street. The other day, I saw four people of color. I was shocked. I mean, in a two-block community. I really was. Right on Railroad Street. One by McDonald's and one by the bank.
I can't speak of it, but it's not obvious to me that you're a person of color. I wouldn't, you're so light, and I wouldn't have guessed it myself, you know? I wouldn't have been aware of it.
So I don't want to cut off your conversation, and I know you both very well and respect you. I do want to make sure other people who have questions get to ask them. And I have to say, frankly, it's a pretty awkward conversation, right? Yes. Most of us who are here are thinking like, boy, we come to these lectures sometimes mainly for edification, and we don't really come for what we're getting here. And it seems like this is the important part because you start to get somewhere. With it.
Yeah. I think this
but
is
it's still a pretty awkward. I know you can handle yourself.
But I love that this connection. Thank you for
it. I'm afraid to cut you off because I don't feel like I'm getting anywhere. I have nowhere to get. I'm just asking the questions.
I think we've gotten a lot of places.
I'm happy to be educated.
Okay.
And I'm going to flip the lights on just so that you can see people because I realize it's hard to see the audience.
Okay, I saw the gentleman here, I think, first. Is that right? Yes.
Well, I don't have answers. I wish I did. I don't think that as a culture, that our country can ever recover from slavery. I was trying to come to grips with the election, the results of the election, and not doing too badly, and I happened to read Ta-Nehisi Coates' article in Atlantic magazine, and that just threw me for a loop. I think it's something that anyone who's interested in it should really, he's just brilliant. And just painted a picture that's an honest picture, but it's very discouraging.
Yes, that's right. Thank you, yes. Did you want to speak? So, yes, so let's, yes.
Well, I'd just like to add that first of all, the first thing that we as white people need to do when we're thinking about this subject is be prepared to listen. And that's a real skill and it takes a lot of effort. The second thing I think we need to do is educate ourselves. And there are multiple ways to do that in this community too. There are people of color in this community working on racism. There are also white people in this community who have been working on racism for decades. So it's here. If you take the time, if we take the time and the effort, there are many things.
I agree with you. Yes.
I may be the only person in this audience who actually saw a Ku Klux Klan demonstration in the 50s.
I have to. Sorry.
I grew up in Alabama. As I came north and became conscious of what the questions really were, even in my own family, I told myself privately that one generation has to die off before there's any chance of opening a dialogue. I hope actually the next generation has seen some improvements, and there's superficial reasons to believe they have. On the other hand, I believe that even today, North and South, there are many people who will say because we've done away with legal segregation that there must not be a problem of racism. And everybody in this audience probably knows that's far from true. Semi-rhetorical question, are we here now ensuring are expecting, are observing that in our schools, that our children are being taught that there is still a problem?
Well, I mean, as an educator, I mean, I do my best, you know, with this. And I think it has to be in the classroom, you know. I think you and I both agree that.
with that. And I think it has to happen right at these early stages. There was an article that was published, I forget, I want to say 10, 15 years ago. Cover of Time magazine, you may remember it. Is Your Baby a Racist? Do you remember this? Very provocative headline. But I read the article and I was interested because the author seemed to assume that his readers were white. And the argument was, we do very well when it comes to educating our children about gender. You know, boys can do anything girls can do, that kind of thing. But when it comes to race, we often, you know, well-meaning white people just ignore it because it is awkward. And we don't want our children to grow up with these histories. And I know for me, confronting this with my own children and recognizing that for me, being introduced, race was trauma. You know, the moments of realizing I was black was realizing I was other, I was lesser. I grew up in the South as well. But I think for a generation, I believe it's different. Maybe not entirely free of those connotations, but I watch my daughters here in Vermont. They experience a lot of pleasure talking about themselves, talking about their skin color. They're very deep brown. And maybe this will, you know, it'll obviously their worlds are gonna, they're 11. They're gonna experience a lot of things, but I love that this is at the foundation. And I'm being educated all the time that there is a kind of different variety of experience now. And I would like to share an anecdote. So my daughters, who are twins, one of their best friends is a boy called Patrick, a little white boy who lives a couple of streets over. He's always at the house. You know, I kind of drive home and there's his bicycle in the front yard. So one day they were sitting around the kids and Julia, my daughter, said she'd like to have tea. I forget what kind of tea now. And I said, Julia, you can't have black tea this close to bedtime. And she said, well, that's racist. And Patrick, in an effort to defend me, said, well, you know, sometimes people are racist without meaning to be. You know, when they say you separate your whites from your darks when you're doing laundry. And the three of us just started laughing because we all knew it was ridiculous what we were saying. But I thought, well, they're working out these terms and what they mean. And in some ways, they're kind of harnessing them. And I'd like to, another anecdote with my daughters, I learn so much from them all the time. And again, about this issue and about how it affects them so differently. We were driving through, and as an African-American growing up in the South, you know, driving through small towns was something you couldn't guarantee that you could be. And still, my parents, you know, we traveled the same route all the time. They picked the gas stations they knew where they'd be treated, where they could be served, you know, et cetera, you know. So I still have that impulse having grown up with that. So we're driving to my husband, who's white, to his home, his house. We adopted our children from Ethiopia. And Julie and I went into a convenience store. And the woman who was waiting on me just, and I think it was just right after the election, she took a few more minutes to recognize me. She was having a conversation with a friend, and it was bothering me. So, and I always wonder, should I bring this up with the girls? So we were in the car again, and I said, you know, it really bugged me that that woman like kept me waiting there. And Julia said, well, maybe she's just racist. I thought, oh wow, that's a kind of different way of thinking about it. So you know, and maybe, you know, we'll just move on. You know, and so you know, she is this, you know, maybe she's just foolish, and she's not gonna, you know, kind of get to us. So. I learn a lot from them. And again, I mean, you know, life is going to take them in a lot of different directions. May I say one more thing, also about Patrick. Riding home on the bus one day, a little boy who's from the Middle East, announced to the bus that he would never marry somebody with skin as dark as my daughter's. So Patrick jumps up, much to the bus driver's, you know, frustration, and just denounces that comment as racist. And then all the kids jump in. And I said to Julia, my goodness, that kind of thing happened to me when I was your age, but no little white kids were standing up for me. And so I thought, this was tremendous. But also with Julia, what she took away from that incident, so she would often encourage me to tell the story to my friends, adults. And I realized that what she took away from it, what she said, you know, I could have beaten him up, I could have taken him, but you know, I chose not to. And I thought this was a moment for her, she'll remember her power and how she chose to restrain herself. It wasn't a moment of shame or humiliation for her. And I thought, wow, this is again, I mean, when I heard this, my heart broke for a moment. I thought, wow, you know, again, remembering my own history, you know, but for her, it wasn't the same thing. And so I see, again, back to Morrison, in some ways, a new narrative that they are composing about who they are. And it's different than the one I don't mean to, you know, offer any easy solutions to a big problem, but I do believe in this generation. And I do believe that we have a generation of young white kids who are conscious and who are active and who want to make interventions. And in some way, that there's any silver lining to what has just recently transpired in this country, but it has awakened and inspired a lot of white people. It's time to stand up, it's time to act. And I think that is something meaningful. The only hope that I can, you know, that I take in watching this, I mean, all the lawyers who were at JFK, the airport, spread out on those cars, you know, who made something happen, it's time to do that. And I see the kids the young kids who, you know, one of the hardest days of my life was the day after the election and having to explain to them, I mean, they grew up that day, that morning. You know, a lot of kids, like, how can someone who's a bully, who says such mean and horrible things, how can this person be? And so it was a moment of growing up for them. And when I had to kind of let go of the reins and say, I don't know. I mean, I'm figuring this out like you are figuring it out. But I watched them respond with such intelligence and strength, and it inspires me. Yes?
I don't have trouble with interracial conversation with you. Let's do lunch. I have more trouble with every one of us have been in this room and heard our friends, or maybe distant friends, because probably everyone in this room makes a pretty strong stand of who and what they represent. When you hear what comes out of some people that they've hidden or they've kept, I'd almost like a worksheet, because it is not the time to belittle them, yell, scream, use, you know, it needs to be done.
Yes.
But you need knowledge to do it,
sure.
Patience to do it. And
yes.
That's where I find the more interaction is really with my contemporaries. And when there is something said, if you can you're meaningful when you say it, even, or work on it, see them again, because we've all been there. Come on.
I
could get a worksheet for that.
That's great. Do you know the, made me think of Peggy McIntosh, the, and yeah, it's the invisible knapsack, and so you can find it online, and it literally is a checklist. So it's worthwhile unpacking the invisible knapsack. You can find it, and you have to kind of, then you it's the everyday appreciation of what it means to be white, what it means to be black. To be followed around in a store, to be able to buy real estate without, you know. I mean, it's really fascinating to approach it that way. And I think this is a really important thing, and I thank you all for coming out, because I think it begins, I believe in the interpersonal, just like you were saying. There's only so much the law can accomplish. You know, there are systematic injustices, but then there are the everyday interactions, and so empathy, I believe, and we talk about the empathy gap now, and we talk about the way actually it does affect the medical profession. You know, the idea that I was reading articles that were so distressing about how many doctors believe that the threshold for pain for black people is higher, that we actually experience less pain, and it affects the way that, and my own physician is white, I just want to make sure, have you read that article? Actually, I'm very sensitive to pain. But these are things that are, I mean, just amazing to contemplate. You think about the repercussions of this. But empathy is hard, particularly when you don't, you know, you're not in touch with people. And bringing it back to Beloved, I think that's what happens in the book with Amy Denver. Now, she's a young white girl who, her attention to Seth's body, the intimate attention she pays to her body, and to understanding and to witnessing the ravages of her back and offering her another story, as opposed to recoiling in horror or hiding her eyes, you know, the kind of color blindness. She confronts it and she offers her own story, and it's just a beautiful moment of kinship. And I believe in that. You know, I think that that is crucial. And having the hard conversations and being wrong and taking that risk to be wrong. When I always tell my students, you know, and I'm not perfect, I tell my students, my goodness, you know, I'm hardly the oracle when it comes to, you know, race relations, but when it comes to issues of gender and sexuality, you know, the way that language changes. And the University of Vermont, you know, we were first, I think, in introducing a third pronoun, you know, they as opposed to he or she. And I didn't know about that. I didn't know because it didn't affect me. And I told my students, you know, when I had to confront that, I was really embarrassed and I was frustrated and I felt myself thinking, this is changing too quickly, you know, and I don't understand. And I thought, wow, this must be what a lot of white people feel, you know, about race. I mean, I felt defensive and I felt like I'm one of the good ones, you know, I can make a mistake in class, like, but understanding what's happening and understanding also that language is supposed to change and that this new generation that's supposed to push these boundaries and what I'm feeling is generational, you know? So I always try to be mindful of that as a way of kind of exercising my own kind of empathy muscles. You know, it's the world is changing. So yeah, that was far afield of what you were saying, but yes.
I don't know whether there's a printed copy of what you said here tonight, because there were a lot of things that you said that I couldn't think about long enough, that I would have to read.
Oh, sure. I'd be happy to. Yes. I'd be happy to make it available. Yeah, maybe I'll contact Allie. We could think about putting it on the VHC website, or I'll talk to Bob about making it. I'd be pleased to do that.
Yeah, we can put it on our website also.
Okay, great. I'll be very pleased to. I'll clean it up. I have a lot of things in the margins. Okay, great. Yes.
I very recently read Beloved, and I was having a lot of trouble with it because, you know, I just couldn't really. I felt like some distance from the character and all the characters, and then, and I was thinking about trauma, and I was thinking about there's a lot of discussion about trauma, and you talked about trying to come up with a balance between forgetting and remembering as a way of surviving.
Yeah.
And it was only like after I read the book, a week or two later, that I realized that I was defending myself by trying to keep that distance there because, you know, if you don't, you know, I don't know, it's so painful.
Yeah, exactly. It's very painful.
Yeah.
And I think we have to confront the limits, you know, we have as human beings.
Yeah.
It's horrible. We were reading, you know, 12 Years a Slave today, and we were talking about some of the horrible scenes. If you've seen the movie, you know, the beating of Patsy. And we were talking about how hard it was to confront that. And even Solomon North, the author, he talks about, he counts all the lashes. And I was thinking, this is the moment where he's protecting himself, as opposed to confronting. Every time that whip made contact with her, she felt that every time. How do you reproduce that, and how do we process that without recoiling and wanting to turn away from it? It's horrible. You know, I think that that's true about so many atrocities that we hear about or witness. You know, it's just awful. Yes?
You probably know these things, so I hate I'm sure you're aware of Vermont, but the Constitution was the first state to outlaw slavery.
That's right.
Right off the bat.
Mm-hmm.
And it was one reason it was going to Canada, it was really getting to Canaan, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing, I don't know if you're aware, that Thaddeus Stevens, who was a crucial motivator of Abraham Lincoln, grew up right next to him. You know, it is a wonderful story, and so I won't belabor. If you're already aware, you can tell you. So Vermont has been aware of the issue and working on it for a long time.
Yeah, I think that it's embedded in the history of it. And you know what? I really like that. It means a lot to me. To say that. I think that sometimes and I do it all the time, I tell my students, we can go a little bit in the direction of the kind of Vermont exceptionalism. You know, and I always tell my, when we read about slavery, my students will often say, oh, those ignorant Southerners. And I'll say, well, you know, they were everyday people, just like you. The man who went to witness that lynching, that was your uncle. You know, that wasn't some, you know, depraved Southern person who's so different. But it is also, it is true that we have that history. And it's also the ironic, the reason why we don't have a big black population here.
My sister and I were having a discussion earlier before we came, and I told her that I thought that the percentage of population of the actual slave owners in the South was like 3 or 4%. Do you know that, or is that a correct figure?
I don't know the correct figure. I do know that the number of the owners of large plantations is very small. You know, there's a kind of a middle class of white people who might have owned a few slaves, but worked next to them in the fields. But that kind of planter class was very small, the people who owned, you know, hundreds of slaves.
Average Southerner didn't own slaves.
Nope. And the average Southerner, again, worked side by side, you know, in the fields.
I don't know that for sure, but I imagine it's right, because there was only 1% of people of the population in the entire country, North and South, all enslaved. Mm-hmm. Now, they were actually fabulously rich. They weren't only the 1% of the population, but they were the 1% of the rich people. And that's one reason why they considered slavery to be such a benefit, because it wasn't beneficial for them. Mm-hmm. They were the ultra-rich.
Yes, very true. There's another Ta-Nehisi Coates essay called The Case for Reparations. You can find it online. Very long essay. But wealth, black bodies as capital, and how it's still, you know, it's fascinating and terrifying to read, or eye-opening, I should say, the benefits of slavery that continue to keep rich people rich, you know, the generational income. It's really worthwhile.
I've been doing some reading lately for a whole body of reasons, but I read that the capital value of the slaves at that time was more than the value of everything else in the country, railroads, everything. It was the capital value of the slaves was more than the capital value of everything else in the United States put together.
It doesn't surprise me.
Just in terms of what they were.
Yeah, that's right. It's very profitable. Okay. Yes. Please.
I moved up here from Charleston about 15 years ago. Uh-huh. And my whole idea was, this is a progressive state, how exciting. But when I first got up here, it was a real culture shock, not seeing any black people. Because I grew up around them, and the culture is so rich. And I really missed that, being up here. But I thought, My ideas of it being quite as progressive as I thought have changed over those 15 years as I've heard of incidents. I have a friend whose daughter, I think, is about 9, 10, or 11, and she's in school, and she says that she gets bullied every day. Mm-hmm. So do all the other black kids in her class. And this woman has been out of work for at least 4 months, maybe longer. And she cannot find a job. She's been everywhere. And I'm convinced it's because she's black and she's, you know, people yell things at her on the street when she's walking. I mean, it's just, it hurts my heart.
These are the stories we need to hear. Uh-huh. This is why we're here, I think, and what Morrison really offers us. Yeah. I'm dying to hear from you, but the people.
Okay. I was just going to say, you're familiar with Alexander Twilight.
Yes.
He was the first black to have graduated from college. Northern building. Solid, he was an incredible man, but that's why they named him the auditorium for
him. Yes, yeah. That's great. Okay, so back here, there's another hand, I think. Yes.
I read just recently, there's a book that's subtitled A Sermon to White America. The title has something to do
with it. Is it Michael Eric Dyson?
Yes, it's Michael Eric Dyson. And it's a wonderful book because it talks a lot about the experience of a sort of educated middle class black man in America, the number of times he's been pulled over and hassled by the cops. But it just talks about sort of the issues that are happening right now and what he thinks about them and some of the arguments. And at the end, he actually says, here's some things I suggest that you can do. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I kind of read it because I knew that there was some at the back, and I always wonder. So that's a book I would recommend.
Oh, that's great. Thank you for that.
And
could you repeat the title, please?
Well, it's by Michael
Eric Dyson.
And it's his latest book, and it's subtitled A Sermon to White America. And it's something about tears in the title. I'm sorry, I'm not always great with names. But I think, you know, what we can do is we can read and we can educate ourselves.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
And we can try when we come to connection and conversation to speak out of that education and also with the realization that conversations are awkward sometimes.
Absolutely. I think if they weren't, then maybe we wouldn't be doing our job.
Yeah.
If we're just very polite to each other.
Right.
You know,
we've been too polite. That's the whole white, not seeing color. That's just being polite and not talking about what's really happened in this world.
I think I agree with you. I'm sorry.
You're looking at the book.
Yeah. I agree. And I tell my students in class, you know, please don't insult me by just agreeing with everything I say. You know, I mean, just we have to have the real, we have to be, what's the point? You know, this is the advantage of just being in a closed space, you know, to be able to talk honestly. And that's how we get to those places. I think you had your hand up, did you? No, am I wrong?
No.
Okay.
I just want to say I read The New Jim Crow a couple of years ago.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I was on vacation at the time.
You did.
And it just opened my eyes to the regulations in our legal system that really discriminate against especially blacks and other minorities, and especially the poor blacks and minorities. And I think it's important that we do educate ourselves about these laws. And it's only since I read that book that I've noticed that people are starting to wake up to these things, like just like the bail system and the whole incarceration and that whole system. But also I was thinking, especially after Trump, obviously knowing nothing about Frederick Douglass today, if you were to talk to Donald Trump, what would you recommend he read? Which is pointless anyway. But what would you recommend that he read that would kind of open his eyes a little bit to what's really happening with the legal system in this country?
I think of New Jim Crow, because you know what it does? It's impossible to refute her facts.
Yeah.
You know, you can read, you know, you might read Ta-Nehisi Coates, you're arguing with him, I don't like this, I don't like that. But when she plots it out, you know, with her documentation and using personal stories too, but it's impossible to come away from that book and not be, you have to, you know, not be aware, not be educated. I had a student today told me that we read that book last semester. He said that was, he was going to go to law school because the book made it clear to him. And again, you know, a young kid from Vermont, it opened his eyes up and it made him feel that he couldn't just sit and be complacent. He had to go and move and try to make changes. But I would say that book to him. It's a long book. It would take him a couple of years. He had to sign it, you know, a few pages at a time. Give him some homework. The New Jim Crow. It's really fast. It's also a book that's not great for the beach. And then when I read it, I had to sort of lie down. You know, it was just overwhelming. Really, because it's happening right around us all the time. But there are so many kind of mechanisms in place to keep it invisible. You know, so we don't see it happening right now. I really think that would be the book. I'm gonna come back here, then come back to you, just to hear some more voices.
Just one more thing. I I was involved with a group that taught meditation in the prisons. And I didn't do it because I was thinking even about race. But when I started visiting prisons and listening to the men who were there, it just opened my eyes. It opened my eyes to what we do, how hard it is when people get out to find a way to restart their lives. And it's very highly black. I mean, I was in Minnesota, which is also a pretty white state, and most of the guys were black. Mm-hmm. And wonderful, some of them. I mean, you're mm-hmm. not usual prison population if you come to a meditation class, so. Just wonderful men.
Well, this is what you were talking about earlier, you know, the disproportionate number of black men in prison doesn't reflect, you know, population at all. And the New Jim Crow.
There's actually a young man, name. He was part of the Baltimore police force until he couldn't stand it anymore. And he started sort of live tweeting all the things that he was witnessing. I wish I could remember his name. And it kind of went rogue and exposed all of the things that were, he was actually commanded to do, which is just round up. He said, you can find any excuse to arrest someone. And if you saw, you could see a black man, if I had to make my quota, a black man on the street, come out, you know, assume the position, you're coming to jail. And he watched, I mean, this and worst happens so much. Oh, the routine humiliations, not just arrests, but humiliations of the black population in Baltimore. And you know what, he spoke up and went against that blue line. And so now we know a lot more than we did before. But, right. I think he's okay. He's actually, he talks about having support of a lot of other officers. You know, there were a lot of people who felt degraded by what they were asking, and they needed somebody to lead them. Yeah. You know, it takes that person. Okay, yes, I'll come back to you.
I was delighted that Humanities and the book, the first Wednesday, chose this book, because I had a particular interest in reading about slavery along the Ohio River between Kentucky and Ohio. Right next to Cincinnati for the last year because of family history of abolition and the Underground Railroad taking place at that time. And I was really struck for good for reading that she was so good in illustrating the destructive, disorienting effects of slavery and what it meant to be on the border then between the free state mm-hmm. and then slave state. It was so good, I can see, bringing out a purple. And my understanding is that she was the first black American woman to get the Nobel Prize in literature for this book.
That's very true, yes, absolutely.
Very impressive. I thought she really nailed it right on the head of what it was all about.
Absolutely, yes. Really. It bears reading, rereading. Yes, yes.
I just want to say, in the United Community Church in Lynn, we're going to do a study on white privilege, so we might see people might want to.
Absolutely.
Join us. The United Church yeah. of Christ has written a curriculum that's online, it's free, mm-hmm. and it deals a lot with.
That's fantastic. Wow. Yes.
Okay. I read Ta-Nehisi Coates' mm-hmm. book, Between the World and Me, and when I try to tell people about it, I'm at a loss for words, so I just say it's the only book. It's some book, and it's not long, and the Athenaeum has it. But one other book that I want to mention is called Waking Up White, and mm-hmm. Being mixed race myself, I wasn't overly impressed with the title. Okay. But then I got to look at the book at a friend's place, and the author is a wonderful woman who really was clueless about why, for instance, an African-American child in her classroom was, you know, able to say just point blank, yeah, when I'm up 18, I'll be in jail, when she started to take in any of the reality. So thanks. I think those are great
Thank you very
opportunities
much.
For learning.
I have your an optic to for you. And you know, I think this is great. And I also think, you know, I think that personal transformation, radical transformations are possible. And I was in Nashville at my parents' house after the 2000,
8 election, Barack Obama, and so many years ago. And we're at the kitchen table, and there was a magazine, and overheard at the gym, a white man talking to another white man, you know, as they were lifting weights, and he's saying, can you believe, you know, 20 years ago I was hanging out with the Klan, and today I voted for a black man for president. And I thought, the end, that's a book right there. But, you know, these things are possible. You know, what does it take? But it's possible. And there's a great article that was published in the Washington Post, and this person should get an award, The White Flight of Derek Black. And it was about a young man who was a leader, a kind of youth leader in the white supremacist, the alt-right white supremacist movement. Did you read this article? Excellent. And it took a village, but he was educated by his people at his university, and it was through reading and through conversation that he realized that he had been taught to resent people of color for their achievements and to see it as kind of personal insult. And his friend said to him at some point, you know what, you're not of this anymore, okay? They would say to him, do you believe in this? No, I don't believe in this. And he had to break. He wrote, his group was being monitored by the Southern Poverty Law Center. And so he sent them a kind of a statement, and they said, we think your thing has been hacked. You know, they didn't believe, no, this is from me. And he renounced all of those beliefs. And so he wrote a piece, I think it was in the New York Times, not long after, I don't know if it was the election or just around the time of the afternoon. And he said, this can change, but of course it took a lot of work on the part of a lot of people. But he was crucial in this movement. And one thing he said actually in the article was, he said to his father, who was devastated when his son broke away, you know, can you believe that Donald Trump is the face of, he's the person we wanted in the White House. And this lunatic, you know, is the one who's, you know, it was terrifying thinking of what's happening now in Steve Bannon, but, and he was mortified himself that what he had put, he realized he had had a role in that. But this is possible. These stories are possible. Yes, you have to.
A novel, I believe it's Roll of Thunder, Hear My Cry.
Yes.
It will bring tears to your eyes.
Yes, and tell briefly, what is that about?
About a family growing up in the South during the Jim Crow.
Roll of Thunder, Hear My Cry. It's a novel.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's a good one.
Okay. And the book you were talking about is Tears We Cannot Stop. A Sermon to White America by Michael Eric Dyson. Tears We Cannot Stop. And I'll give that a look as well. Yes?
You know, someone knows my name. It's a novel based on history about a young 12-year-old girl in Africa, African village, the long march to the coast, the horrible boat ride, slavery in the South, finally going north, back to Africa, and eventually into
London. Wow.
It's fabulous.
What is it called?
Someone Knows My Name.
Someone Knows My Name. I'll write that down too. I'm going to write all this down. It's fantastic. And it's a memoir or a novel?
It's a novel based on
history. Okay. That's wonderful. Have you read the book The Known World?
Yes.
I adore that book. It's a novel, and it's a beautiful story about the slaveholding South and really about relationships and the complexity of relationships between Black people. The premise is a Black man who owns slaves himself. So down to those deeply human questions. It's a wonderful book. I loved it. Yes?
Could you please put the names of some of these books at the end of the paper you're going to put on?
Yes, I will. It'll be different than Donald Trump's. A little more sophisticated. Yeah. Yes.
Mercy.
Yes.
Just Mercy.
Just Mercy. Yes. Yes.
One more book. The Warmth of Other Suns.
Yes.
And that talks. It's a large book. It talks talks about the migration of from the south to the north in various narratives.
Yes. Amazing work. I think it's fantastic. We're sharing information, we're sharing stories, we're educating each other. That's great. You know, I mean, I really, this is what it's about, right? Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, good night. Maybe I'll see you again.